When we think about the Mesozoic era, what often comes to mind is the variety of reptiles that once dominated the lands, seas, and skies of the Jurassic and Cretaceous periods. But these animals were far from alone, and often overlooked are the myriad of other creatures that were doing just as weird things and setting their own evolutionary records. In case you didn't already know, the earliest period in this time frame, the Triassic, had a lot of really weird things going on. So many that this channel is going to be dedicated to exploring as many of them as possible in this series. Triassic. What the f- Alright, we're back to the old roots while I take a break from working on massive media reviews. That video will be coming out soon, I promise. I'm not gonna Benji Thomas yell with this. Anyway, there's no special occasion or themed thing going on with this one. I just wanted to talk about these brand new beetle buddies that were officially described back in early July that you might have heard a little bit about. You could say it's a pretty crappy story, but in a good way. For us, at least. For the beetles, not so much. As usual, we'll begin with the discovery of the fossils themselves, which takes us to the village of Krasiejów in southwestern Poland. Here beneath the feet of its roughly 2,000 human inhabitants lie layers of ancient mudstone and limestone, creating a fossil bed called the Kuiper Claystone, preserving what would have been a semi-coastal region some 230 million years ago, with streams and lakes crisscrossing and dotting a swampy landscape dominated by ferns, cypress-like conifers, and tree-like horsetails in a seasonal, subtropical environment. Over the course of the last 20 years, if not more, outcrops of these old rocks have played host to numerous fossil digs, uncovering a variety of animals from fish and giant amphibians to strange reptiles that looked more like crocodilians than the variety of actual croc cousins that lived alongside them. In addition to bones and plant remains, paleontologists have also found a number of coprolites, which, in case you didn't know, are fossilized pieces of dung. Coprolites are not uncommon in the fossil record, and they are arguably one of the most interesting pieces of evidence of ancient life that the Earth churns up, since they allow you to see what the animal that made the scat was eating, sometimes in remarkable detail. Coprolites have preserved everything from bone and plant stems to shells, muscle fibers, feathers, and hair, with many keeping their three-dimensional shape. You can take it a step further by looking at the wear patterns and preservation quality of the individual bits and pieces of animal and/or plant matter to get an idea of how the consumer's digestive system worked and what kinds of food it would have preferred to snack on. One of the more iffy aspects of coprolite study is determining the identity of the perpetrator, since animals usually just leave their droppings any old place and keep it moving. That said, combining the size and information obtained from a coprolite with clues regarding dietary habits from the anatomy of the animals in the region, it's possible to point fingers at a likely suspect. In the case of many of the Krasiejów coprolites, the paleontologists studying these specimens have assigned their origin to Psilosaurus opalensis, a dog-sized four-legged reptile that may or may not be a dinosaur. The exact classification of Psilosaurus and its close relatives has been uncertain for decades, generally hovering somewhere near the base of the dinosaur family tree. However, the most recent study on this topic places them as the ancestors of the Ornithischian dinosaurs, so everything from the duck-billed hadrosaurs and speedy little ornithopods, to the horned ceratopsians and bone-headed pachycephalosaurs, to the spiked stegosaurs and heavily armored ankylosaurs, all might have their origins in animals like Psilosaurus. This is something that's definitely still up for debate, but their true taxonomic identities aren't particularly important to this story. All we really care about here is that they were at least dinosaur-adjacent, and they made these prehistoric poops. Since 2016, a team of Swedish and Polish paleontologists led by Martin Kvarnström have used a form of CT scanning called synchrotron microtomography to get a peek inside these coprolites to see what exactly these psilosaurs were eating. Using the equipment housed at the Synchrotron Radiation Facility in Grenoble, France, they published their first batch of results in a 2019 paper, finding a mix of different insect remains, most of them disarticulated. A leg here, an antenna there, etc. But in one of their final specimens, a small 17 by 21 millimeter piece which was scanned in late 2019 as part of their ongoing work, Kvarnström and his team found something unusual. The tiny, often partially if not nearly complete remains of beetles, with amazingly intact preservation rivaling that of specimens found in amber. With nobody on the team specifically versed in identifying and classifying beetles, they reached out to a number of entomologists, including Martin Fikacek, who was based at Taiwan's National Sun Yat-sen University. When Fikacek joined the team, he was sent the images of the fossils and was himself genuinely surprised by their level of preservation and completeness. With 14 specimens in total, he was able to identify enough unique anatomical features to determine that these not only represented a new species of beetle, but they were from a family with a spotty fossil record that was in need of a substantial boost, especially ones from this stage in their evolutionary history. To better understand the significance of these fossils, we have to go take a step back to look at beetle diversity, and there's a lot to see. Believe it or not, beetles are actually the most specious group of animals on the planet. With over 400,000 known species around today, they make up about 40% of all known insects and a quarter of all known animals, and new ones are still being discovered on a regular basis. Given this, I'm genuinely surprised that there's no National Beetle Day. Well, there is a National Beetle Day, but not the right one. Molecular evidence shows that the last common ancestor of all modern beetles, aka coleopterans, dates back as far as the Permian period, some 285 million years ago, and fossils of even earlier ancestors of the beetle lineage come from rocks as old as the Carboniferous, so they've been around for a pretty long time. Today's beetles are split into four main groups. The largest, and the one whose members you're probably most familiar with, is the Polyphaga. These include, but are in no way limited to, ladybugs, fireflies, rhinoceros beetles, weevils, and dung beetles. Going down in group size, we have the Ataphaga, which include familiar faces like the diving beetles and the tiger and bombardier beetles. The two smaller and less familiar clades are Myxophaga and Archostomata, which are generally considered sister groups and the oldest of the modern beetle lineages. You probably wouldn't know or recognize any members from either of them, seeing as they're rare and or very small, plus they've got no common names listed on Wikipedia, which is how you know an animal's obscure. Archostomatans don't really have any defining characteristics aside from just having primitive anatomy relative to other beetles, while Myxophagans are tiny semi-aquatic critters that feed on algae in freshwater habitats throughout the world, leading some specialists to start calling them bog beetles. Based on his analysis of the Triassic coprolite beetles, Fikacek was able to determine that they belong to the Myxophagans, and so the species was named Trimyxa coprolithica. For those who want to get technical, the features that were used to classify it as a Myxophagan include widely separated mesococci, pentagonal mesoventral elevation, coxal plates, long terminal tarsomeres, and small overall body size. Indeed, most of the 120 known living bog beetles are dang near microscopic, and at only about 1.5 millimeters long, Triomyxa is no different. For perspective, that's barely over half the size of your typical large fruit fly. In fact, they're so small that many species can easily form entire clusters of dozens of individuals within a single damp patch of water only millimeters deep, which helps explain why so many Trimyxa fossils were found in such a small coprolite.
This is what we know actually for the modern Myxophaga, because they live in kind of the algal mats. So if you have like a sun-exposed wet rock or something that's like here in Taiwan, we even collected it on like a concrete wall with some like water going from the street, so it was like continuously wet and some thin like layer of water was flowing on the concrete wall. It was on the full sun, so it kind of has good condition for algae to grow up because it was like lots of sun, warm and water, right? So in this habitats, once it's like covered by algae, this can be super full of these beetles. These habitats are very frequently very temporary. So actually, once we discovered it 2 years ago here in Taiwan, the students returned to the place 1 month later, and it was dry. The place where we like a month ago found millions of these beetles, there was nothing, it was totally dry. So they have to have some way how to, once they find a good spot, they somehow kind of breed super quickly to kind of, you know, like use and explore this place. And the fact that the dinosaur has so many specimens in the coprolite actually kind of suggested probably it was somehow similar at that time already. Because, yeah, so like they occur in masses today in good spots, and evidently they were in masses already in the Triassic. So that's kind of a parallel which also indicates probably they even lived in the same way, in the algal mats.
So how do these tiny insects spend their days, and what can that tell us about their Triassic relatives? Well, unfortunately, due to their small size and seemingly transitory nature, even modern Myxophagans are actually not very well studied, so it's not known where they go when their moist microhabitats dry out. All we know for sure is that they know how to take advantage of whenever and wherever the water is. While their limbs are not specialized for swimming, their feet have large claws that help them maintain a grip on moist surfaces as they walk along wet sand, dirt, or algae-covered rocks as they forage. The mouthparts of Triomixa are themselves too small to clearly see at the resolution of the scanner used for the study, so their specific morphology and functions are a bit hard to tell right now. However, based on modern relatives, it's likely that they were adapted for feeding on algae, lacking galliae, a common feature of the group, and bearing a mobile tooth on their left mandible to help better manipulate and cut through their slippery food. One of the most interesting things about Triomixa is that it might provide a clear example of sexual dimorphism from the fossil record. If you look at the underside of the abdomens of the beetles, some specimens have 5 segments called ventrites, while others have a 6th, slightly elongated one that looks more triangular-shaped. This same structure can be seen in some modern mixophagans, like the hydroscaphids, which led the researchers to classify Triomixa as close to this group, though not close enough to be part of that family, rather keeping it in its own newly made family, Triomixidae. But it isn't necessarily sexually dimorphic. In them and some other insects, the 6th ventrite is present in both males and females, and can be more or less retracted into the body. However, in many other insects, the triangular ventrite contains a small rod-like organ called an adygus, which is basically the arthropod version of a penis. One of the Triomixa individuals with 6 ventrites even appears to show this organ slightly protruding from the end of its abdomen, lending support to the idea that the 2 morphs represent 2 different sexes, with those having 5 ventrites being females and those with 6 ventrites being males. If this holds up on closer examination in future studies, it'll prove to be a good example of the value of having a large enough sample size to help identify things like sexual dimorphism in fossil organisms. So how did they ultimately end up in the digestive tract of Ancylosaurus, and why are they generally so neatly preserved? Being so small, it's hard to imagine that even a moderately sized animal like Ancylosaur would actually be able to identify and selectively feed on one. There's also the fact that they generally only appear in 1 or 2 of the total number of coprolites scanned during this research, which suggests that they probably weren't a regular or at least intended target. The larger arthropods, which appear more regularly throughout the samples, were probably the main food source. Their fragmented nature probably means that, unlike the Triomixa, they were actually large enough to be properly broken down by the reptile's digestive system. All of these factors led the researchers to suggest that these 14 prehistoric bog beetles were unlucky collateral damage, getting unintentionally scooped up as the Ancylosaurus was either nipping at larger insects passing by, or taking a drink near the edge of a pond where a group of Triomixa happened to be chilling in mass on their algal mats, unaware of the fate that was about to befall them. Of course, despite their preservation, these tiny critters weren't alive when they exited the Ancylosaur's digestive tract. But what amounted to a shitty day for them proved a boon for paleontologists, providing a fascinating window into the past and adding a new layer to the value of coprolites that Kvarnström hopes will lead to further research into these prehistoric droppings.
So if we want to look at the rise of dinosaurs, we have to look at all possible aspects, including diets and sort of interaction with other animals, to try to understand this this success of the dinosaurs, if you will. This is, of course, a very small piece to that puzzle, but I think if we look at the food webs and also compare food webs through time, we can get a bit of a better understanding both of like individual dinosaurs or other vertebrates, what they were doing, eating, and so on. But also the ecosystem as a whole, because it's really direct evidence of feeding. So we can, even if it's hard to link coprolites to producers sometimes, we know if we have a coprolite containing this and that, but there was an animal around eating this and that of approximately this size, so for example. So I think we're just taking the first few steps in understanding these kind of things, but that's going to be very interesting. My perspective, and also of course this combination of trying to find out what these different animals were eating and into how they were interacting, and at the same time be able to discover new fossils and very well preserved ones. It's I think a very cool combination.
Indeed, the Ancylosaur coprolites preserve more than just animal remains, and the story of this specimen doesn't end with the reptile's anus. The fossils containing the bog beetles also yielded fiber structures that might be either the algae that the Triomixa were eating and or elements of fungal stems that took root in the dung while it was still fresh, recycling its leftover nutrients back into the environment alongside colonies of bacteria that also left their mark in the fossils via gas bubbles produced by fermentation. This rich complex of decomposers is often overlooked in prehistoric and even modern-day ecosystems, but they're just as important as the largest dinosaur, composing a crucial element of the great circle of life that Mufasa taught us about. And I think that really underscores the major theme of this series. From bacteria to beetles to the dung they were preserved in, it's the small, often less glamorous things that often make such a huge difference. And understanding and being able to recognize those elements in any ecosystem, extant or extinct, are what will truly help us grasp the dynamic complexities of our living planet.
Oh.